Hello there, gang. Welcome back to the big board. Let's take a look at Plan 1919. It's a Hollenspiel title. Let's see which number it is out of the gate for them. Is it on the box here somewhere? Usually it is. Number 8. And I thought what we might do is just kind of meander our way through some commentary on this game. It's not obviously not a review, since I'm only part of the way through this gameplay here, where we're kind of getting deep into game turn 3 at the moment. And the game's premise, I might as well just read it to you off the back of the box here, is that explores the most influential campaign that ever was, JFC Fuller's revolutionary plan to use new tank technology to penetrate past front lines and going for a shot through the brain. So it's a hypothetical situation, and you have a pretty high scale game. It's armies, sorry, it's corps and divisions. It's an interesting system, also. Let's just say that, and we'll talk a little bit more about it as we go through kind of the cycle here. You're making decisions at the, I would call it probably corps or army level, where you're deciding where groups of divisions are going to function and what they're going to do. Your decisions are basically a factor hunting exercise to identify the best way to get the optimal mix of odds and DRMs and column shifts to allow you to cause these types of breakthroughs that we're seeing here. Let's zoom in on these guys a little bit. And those counters do, in fact, look a little pink. I had someone mention that, but I assure you, they're a very light gray. So, you know, generating these sort of breakthroughs is what's going to bust up the line in a non-World War One kind of way and allow this deeper penetration so that you can achieve the goal, which is to capture these flagged areas here, right? So you can see, where are they? There's 2, 3 there. There's Cologne or whatever it is there. So if you do that, basically you win as the Allies. If you thwart that, you win as the Germans. Now, interestingly, the role you're playing has really stepped up pretty high. And my first look at the game before I punched it, I was kind of stunned at the volume of units and the caliber of the units that were facing off against each other. So you can see there's lots and lots of French 2/4s. There's lots and lots of British 3/5s, and then there are the larger divisions, which are two-step 7/5 American divisions. You flip them over to take a loss, and they become a kind of traditional size division. And you'll notice on the backs of these guys, they have these entrenchment markers, so you need to be entrenched or in move mode, basically. And so I was kind of stunned by the volume of units. And I'm not a World War One aficionado, so I can't tell you whether or not this is historically accurate or inaccurate. It would be given that it's posited to be sometime, I guess, in 1919. So, and there are some adjustments made in the game design notes and all the rest of it. It talks about, you know, certain units would have been moved hither and yon, and this is what we think the situation would be like. So it's all very well justified, and that's fine. Hypotheticals, you can pretty much make shit up, right? And say, here's what it is, and I'm going to take this piece of historical data and tune it this way. So this role kind of bumps you up a fairly high level, but my point about the units, you know, that I'm trying to get to awkwardly is that there are basically 500 combat factors facing the Allies facing off against 131 factors for the Germans. So right off the bat, even without any technological advantage with air or tanks, we've got almost a 5-to-1 ratio, so we're going to do okay as the Allies. And whether or not that okay means that you will be able to win decisively? I don't know, but the way the game rules are set up, it's making you make some pretty hard choices here and there, which is good. And we'll get into that in a second. So everything, all the information is pretty much available on the map. There's no hidden units or movements. And let's double check to make sure I'm not, I hadn't been playing this incorrectly. I do believe that you can look at your enemy's units. So basically you can rummage through them and work out what your odds are and all that sort of fun stuff. So it's full, full God's eye view. And that is what it is, right? The other thing that I found was interesting is that in particular for combat, tanks play a pivotal role, but more importantly, the mode you're in. If you're entrenched and behind a river, so you're doubled for being entrenched, you're doubled for being behind the river. And if I was in this hex here, if this city here, of course, Neufchâteau, and that was behind a river, I'd be doubled three times. So you can literally create enormous bastions of defense. If you're not entrenched, like this little fella here, then you're just three factors. Now you're three factors doubled behind the river, three factors doubled again. For being in the city or perhaps being in rough terrain, whatever the case might be. So you're going to get cumulative effects as well, but you don't start off double. That plays into decisions because a 3-1 is moving one movement point. Now there is a rail factor, but you can only move six X's by rail per turn, as the Germans. So your movement rate is very limited, which means if I'm not entrenched, I have a penalty, a defensive penalty. If I am entrenched, I have a movement penalty. And here we can see where there was a breakout, a breakthrough. These guys came in and around this way, or actually in through here and out this way. And these guys couldn't react fast enough. If you want to come out of entrenchment, it takes all your movement points. So you flip out of entrenchment, and then next turn you can move, which by then, these guys have got two moves on you. So tough decisions. So there's that element of it in terms of decision making. And then the other factor is on the CRT. If you're going to play this game and use your tanks, you're going to have to be prepared to take losses. Obviously, left slash is the attacker's loss, right slash is defender's loss. And it's tricky to get to 3-1, 4-1 here, which even here there are losses that you don't want to take. You're taking a loss no matter what. And if you're using your armor to get a bonus or the DRM bonus to move you up the food chain of results, or if you're using your air, your first loss when you use armor has to be an armored unit. And what happens to those armored units? Well, they go back on the game track. And so, we've got to, I haven't rolled for all these guys yet here. But I've got to roll a d6 and add one, and that is the number of turns that they come back in. That's modeling the reproduction of the forces or additional new tanks coming online and all the rest of it. So that all works just fine. But the loss ratios can be pretty stark. If you're on a 4-1 attack and you roll a 1, or a, well, you can't roll a 1 if you're using armor because you're going to get a plus 1 DRM. But let's say you roll a 4, you're going to take 2-step losses. Now, you may inflict 3 losses on the enemy, and you'll get this breakthrough opportunity, and you'll have this, there's an exploit phase and all this sort of fun stuff. So there is some secondary movement. But it's only for these armored and light armored or medium armored cav units. The heavy armor doesn't get to move again. None of the infantry gets to move again. So clustering your forces is important for the breakthrough, and then you've got to let everything catch up and then go again. Now, right at this moment here, we're trying to put all these dudes out of supply and isolate a huge chunk of the army and let the British or some other forces barrel on through to Dusseldorf. Now, of course, there are German, there are some German reinforcements, some not reinforcements, but in fact, there's not. There's two, there's one, two, no? There's none. There are really no German reinforcements, other than getting some air replacements back. The air war in this game is fairly abstracted, and it, based on my gameplay so far, I don't see a way. I've experimented quite a bit, in fact. You know, there's no way for the Germans to survive any individual combat unless they get extremely edge case lucky on a die roll. And so you really don't, you play turn one, put all the German air units aside, they go back onto the replacement track, which is fine on the turn track, 1d6 turns later, plus one, and that's fine. But they're going to come back and they're going to die. So let's kind of mute point it and move on, and then decide, do we want to use the you know, significant amount of air that's available to the Allies? How do we want to use it? Where do we want to use it? And the only limitation is a five-step stack point, 5 steps of air in a hex, and being within 10 hexes of a city or a base or something like that. The whole basing thing doesn't seem very clear to me in the rules. There are a couple of little things with contact type. It's called contact aircraft that I don't necessarily understand 100%. Neither here nor there. The game works. You're getting a column shift here anyway. It's one column shift, so it's not making a huge difference. If you're bringing a massive force to the battle, you are going to be able to get close to 5 or 6 to 1 and a 1 or 2 DRM. So you almost don't need the air, particularly given the fact that you have a 5 to 1 ratio of combat points. So the choice you're going to make, one of the choices you do have to make, is how quickly do I want to fritter away my armor? Because I have to take a step loss, right? So in nearly every attack, in fact, I do have to take them in all attacks. And I want to run the risk of, if I roll poorly for the replacements for them, that they will be 7 turns away, which is going to have to, which may slow my offense down. That can happen, and that would be a bad thing. But as you can see here in turn 3, I've got 1, 2, I've got 2 armor coming back, then another 2, 3 armor coming back the next 2 turns. The armor, my strategy here, so for this game, I think you go all out, you go all in. You focus your forces in a very discrete, specific location. I chose 3 locations based on the way the defense was set up. One with the Americans up here, one with the British here, and then a kind of a diversionary attack down here with the French, which ended up being relatively successful, all things considered. They've kind of been fighting by themselves here with a bunch of crappy units, and only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, well, they had 7 armored brigades, so that's a lot of armor. So they did okay. The challenge here is free setup. You have absolute discretion as the German to set, as long as you set up east of this setup line that runs along here, this type of terrain on the map, you can set up anywhere you like. So you could set up a very thin defense here and see how bad the breakthrough was, and then adjust, and then have a more robust second line following this river, set of rivers, and the woods here all double you up and all that sort of stuff. So you could set up a pretty tough line. In fact, I bet possibly from Antwerp to Liege to here, then you've got 1 clear hex you need to toughen up, and then you've got woods all the way across here. So there is certainly room for lots of exploration here, which is one of the things I like about the game. What I have found in this 4-map setup is that it's a little crowded. There's a lot of units on the board. They're big counters. Each counter is almost sticking. It is, in fact, sticking over one edge somewhere. So, your stacking is 5 steps. That's a lot of counters to keep track of, and they've got that nice satin finish, so they look good and they feel nice, but they tend to get slippery. And when we're dealing with massive forces like this, it's difficult. It would almost have been nicer to perhaps have less units and more steps. So, making these cores, maybe having some sort of representative core counter that I could take three divisions or five divisions and put it into a core and know that that was 3 times 5 was 15, or 5 times 3 is, yeah, 3 times 5 is 15. And that I could just have one unit here instead of five units here. And if I wanted to break them down, maybe I could do that. That, to me, that would have made this less cluttered, less difficult to, from a usability standpoint. Everything else works fine on the map. The CRT and the game turn sequence and the terrain effects are all right here. Every hex costs a movement point to move through, except rough, which is double. It's two. So the game works well. The mechanics work well. I'm looking at this at this point with the defensive setup that the Germans have had and realize that it's largely over for the German player here. So we're either going to reset or look for an opportunity to play this with somebody so we have this opposed experience, which I think would be a deeper, richer experience than what we're currently getting out of this at the moment. It was fun to identify the weak points and find a breakthrough, but this turn coming up, we're going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We're going to be in liege. We could almost set up a line here and defend this area here and channel, keep all these forces isolated, force the Germans to attack us at average, average odds, taking step losses all the time, and then push all these French guys through and just form a wedge, and it's pretty much game over. Only these units up here could possibly escape. None of these units can escape, and all these guys are already dead. No replacements here for these losses, basically. There's a German unit in that bay. So, what else can we talk about here that I think is interesting? I think the playtime will be once you're set up, once you make your decisions about where you want to set up, turns move pretty quickly because you're not attacking all along the line. You could, that's another strategy, is if you're prepared to take a step loss, you can. You've got 5 to 1 on, 5 to 1 on everybody. So I can take a step loss and you've got to lose one. Well, that's a good thing. As long as I get into the 2 to 1 table, I only have one chance in 6 of losing a step. But I may lose 2 steps though in 3 of those cases. So you probably want to have at least 3 to 1 odds. So if I can get 3 to 1 on you, I'm going to start chipping away at you, and life is going to get hard for you quick. Straight up easy, 7 pages of rules, nice to consume, pretty fast to play, I think. I don't know that you'll play many games through to conclusion to 20 turns. Just don't know that I could see that once a breakthrough happens and you start pocketing and stuff, it's kind of over for the Germans, and it's a matter of then if you really want to go all the way. I don't know that this game is engaging enough to make you go all the way to 20 turns every time you play. So there's and the only other thing I would say, let's just check the supply rule here real quickly. And what is that actually going to do for you? I think each side has different supply rules. The Germans have the most restrictions on them because they have to be within range of an HQ. It's just 5 hexes. And the downside of being out of supply is what? Again, before marching, railing, and combat, and also exploit, what happens? It doesn't say. All right, I'll check this. Hang on a sec. Yeah, that's right. You are halved if you're out of supply for combat. So that's going to have an impact. The other thing was, just as I wrap the things up here, obviously there's a retreat and advance after combat rules and all that sort of good stuff. American infantry divisions actually do get replacements, so you put them on the track. The replacement rates are different for both sides for the armor that if it's lost in the anti-tank guns that are available. The Germans roll 2d6, not 1d6. So anyway, I know it's kind of a long look at this game, but it's worth a look. I don't know the value, price and value point here in terms of game replay value. I think this is a relatively expensive game for the gameplay you get out of it. If you don't get five or six gameplays out of this, then I'm not sure it's good value. But now, as opposed to some of the other titles from Hollenspiel, which I think offer great value for money because they are very engaging and replay value is extremely high, like Agricola and the Teutons game. I find that to be looks like that's going to be highly replayable. I haven't played it yet, but just based on the fact that it has three battles in it, you're already ahead of the curve there. A lot of the Sword and Shield games, they have some good replay value just because of the mix of chits that you can use for tactics and things. This one here, maybe not as much, but the variable setup and free setup for both sides really does offer you a significant number of choices. I just don't know whether this is kind of crunchy enough here for me. You're really looking for breakthrough exploit opportunity. And then once that occurs, yeah, okay. So yeah, that was the fun part. Now all we're doing is grinding out to the end. Anyway, Plan 1919, Hollenspiel. It's a, try and pronounce John's last name, Gorkowski title. I think it's a good effort. The map art is gorgeous and the counters are very effective and efficient and easy to read. So all in all, an interesting game. Let's move on to the next thing, shall we? All the best.